The Lord be with you. Please stand. Let us pray. Almighty God and our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day that you have given us. Lord God, we thank you for the precious gift of life. We thank you, Lord, for family. We thank you for friends. We thank you, Lord God, for the privilege of sharing fellowship. And we thank you, Lord God, for this time as we come to celebrate the death of our, the parting of our brother, Darnley. And loving Father God, as we come to celebrate his life, we also come before you, Lord, in worship. This is an act of worship. And so, Lord God, because we can do nothing without you, we pray for the presence and the guidance of your Holy Spirit. Lord God, that all that we think and speak and do in this hour may bring you honor and glory. Father, we ask these mercies in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed. Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We brought nothing into this world, and we take nothing out. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. With faith in Jesus Christ, we receive the body of our brother Darnley for burial. Our brother was washed in holy baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore, with confidence, pray to God our Heavenly Father, the giver of life, that he will raise him to perfection in the company of the saints. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day our brother Darnley. Father, we thank you for giving him to us, his family and friends, to know and love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Rest eternal, grant unto him, O Lord.
And let thy perfection shine upon him.
Our opening hymn 515. Come, we that love the Lord, and let our joys be known. Join in the song with sweet accord, and thus surround the throne. Kindly be seated. We now invite Peter Carter to pay a tribute to our deceased brother.
Donnelly Lowe. A brief bio: his parents were Ellen and Sidney Lowe. The siblings, Carolyn, or Aunt Car, Millicent or Mina, and Cynthia. As a boy, he showed a great intelligence at school, St. Luke's Boys School, always aiming for excellence. And he started his working career at McInerney's. We have tributes from family, friends, workmates. Three workmates who became very close to Darnley were Joan Bess, Amy, and Prince. And Joan noted that Darnley started as a mechanic, also at a later time became timekeeper or payroll clerk for a number of years. He had a humble, quiet nature, was a man of few words. He loved to sing a hymn or a chorus. He loved to listen. And this is something that kept coming up in the tributes. His son, Robert, first word that he used was humble. Orlando described him as a man who could enjoy solitude. He enjoyed being quiet and peaceable. He was well loved by mechanics and managers at work, and you could depend on him. His niece, Sylvester Ford Rollup, she says he was a good uncle. Regularly visited their home on weekends, and Darnley and his sister, Aunt Car, often sang gospel songs together while Sylvester and her siblings would join in the singing. And they spent many enjoyable hours in Darnley's company. Junie Lowe, who his niece again, lived in the same home. She says from childhood, and she's speaking directly to Darnley, from childhood to adulthood, you were always there for me. You were compassionate, loving, kind, caring. You epitomize what makes a family. As a child waiting for you to come home, I would stand at the top of the stairs, looking through the window we call the office, to see you with newspaper and the usual brown paper bag with nuts and sugar cakes from Rhonda the nut seller, whistling as you entered. Always neatly dressed with your pens inside a Firestone protector in your shirt pocket. You were a filial son, reading the newspaper aloud to your mother, Ma, who was blind, so that she could keep up to date with what was going on. You were my first teacher. I have so much gratitude and appreciation for the advice you gave me. You always made the sandwiches. Those were good. When there was this St. Luke's Church Army excursion on Christmas bank holiday, you would hire Mr. Pretty or Careful Hands to drive us following the buses going north. These were great family outings. In your advanced years, you were brave enough to travel to two continents to visit UK, US, and Canada. Nieces Pauline Thompson and Nalene or Esteline Blenman. They said that Darnley was like a father to them when they were growing up. He ensured that they were well taken care of when their parents emigrated to the UK a few years before they were able to send for the children. They remember the special attention he paid to keeping their shoes in excellent condition. And again, every Friday, he made sure to bring home treats, such as comforts, nuts, and sugar cakes. Niece Colleen Byer saw Darnley as a father figure. always singing, knew almost all the hymns in the hymn book, never got angry with anyone. And her mother would take her to town, and they would pass a visit down there at work. Then one day the mother said, "I don't have the time to do that." And Colleen stood her ground and refused to move until the mother relented and took her to see her beloved Darnley. Cynthia Allen says Darnley patterned his life on the fruit of the Spirit: love, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, humility, self-control. However, for her, humility stood out, as she considered humility to be the hallmark of Darnley's life. His caretaker, Beverly Morris, called him Darn Darn, and she would speak to him often. He might not speak as often, but when he did speak, it was something that brought laughter to her day. The most amazing thing for her, for which she gives God thanks, was that he remained in his right mind. And one of her memories was how difficult it was to trick him. So when he felt that he didn't really want to eat, she would say, "Only 3 more spoonfuls." And then after that, he would count. 1, 2, 3. So if she tried to give more, he would say, "No, no, no, that is 3. You said 3? That is 3. So they had good times together. The Carters from Messiah Street, Lorraine Carter, you know, was Darnley's niece, and her children became familiar with Uncle Darnley going back from the early 60s. Charmian recalls fondly her visits to the home with her daughter Rachel. We, including yours truly, we all love to spend time at Darnley's home, just like the persons who live there: Esteline, Junie, Costa, Lisa, Jackie. We were treated as though we were Darnley's children. Everything was just one big happy family. He was a very friendly person, worked hard to provide for his family, not one to waste time, generally speaking. As quiet as he was, you could still get some lively comment when you discussed cricket or motor vehicles or family matters. His daughter Lisa notes that one of his favorite songs was "My Savior, First of All." And he prayed for his family, for his children, particularly after his teenage son passed away in a road accident, Selwyn. And he would pray for them one by one and consistently. His passion for family, according to Lisa, extended to animals. He would have dogs with names like Boy Black and Beulah, strange names. He would feed them 2 or 3 times a day, and they also had to endure a daily bath, because as far as he was concerned, cleanliness is next to godliness. She says, "I'm not sure whether my father loved change, but he accepted that it was inevitable. And so when Esteline bought her microwave oven, Lisa was adamant that he would not use it, only to find a couple of days later or a couple of weeks later, when she visited, that he was explaining to her how to prepare scrambled eggs in the microwave." So even at age 80, he was still relatively open to change, and he could deal with technology. At school, he actually was recommended by his headmaster to teach maths, but in the end, his parents decided to send him to do an apprenticeship. And then eventually he went into the mechanic field and then got back into the office, I guess, when he became the timekeeper at McInerney. And finally, his another son, Costa. He says Dad was a man of routine. His father would wake up early each morning, kneel down and pray for 30 minutes, exercise for another 30 minutes, with sit-ups and push-ups and stretches. Then he would take a shower, read his Bible, read his newspaper. And in the afternoon, he would repeat much of this process. So he was very much a man who stuck to his routine. And he continued this even after he retired, making sure that he allotted time to cleaning the house, clearing the yard, keeping everything neat and tidy. For him, though, Sunday now was a day of worship, Bible reading, and singing church hymns. He loved the Lord. And I believe all this contributed to his long life. On behalf of Donnelly's family, I extend gratitude to all those who paid tribute, to all his extended family, his friends, to all of you who have shown your appreciation for Donnelly by being here today, whether here in person or online. Thank you very much.
Our second tribute takes the form of a song entitled, "It Is Well With My Soul," and this will be rendered by Sidney Ramsey.
When peace like a river attended my way, when sorrows like sweet billows should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ has regarded my shed his own blood for my soul.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we remember before you today your servant Darnley, and we pray that having opened to him the gates of a larger life, you will receive him more and more into your joyful service, that with all who have served you in the past, he may share in the eternal victory of Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Our first Bible reading, taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. And this will be followed immediately by Psalm 23.
A reading from the Word of God, written in the first epistle of Paul the Apostle to the Thessalonians, chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. For this we declare to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will by no means precede those who have died. For the Lord himself, with a cry of command, with the archangel's call, and with the song of God's trumpet, will descend from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up in the cloud together with them to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Our second Bible reading, taken from John chapter 11, verses 21-27, will be done by Miss Carolyn Blackman.
A reading from the Word of God written in John chapter 11, verse 21-27. John 11:21-27. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you have been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one who coming into the world." The word of the Lord.
The hymn before the homily, "Through all the changing scenes of life, in trouble and in joy, the praises of my God shall still my heart and tongue employ."
Thank you.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Amen. Please sit. I'm sure that all of us here at some time or another have experienced grief. Whether we call it grief or sorrow or mourning, we have all been there. Wives, husbands, parents, children, brothers and sisters react at the final remains of a loved one. And people from all walks of life, rich, poor, who hold position, those who hold positions of power and influence, some who do not, young and old, black and white, we all experience grief. And I know from a personal experience that grief is more than just sadness. It takes place on a deeper level. It is physical, emotional, and spiritual. We feel the pain, our hearts race, tears flow. We even at times lose our appetites. We get weak knees, and we feel emotionally drained. We can't focus. Our mind races in a dozen directions all at once, and we call to mind long forgotten memories. We even mentally rehearse conversations that we planned to have but never got around to with our loved ones. The grief cuts all the way to our souls, because grief is a spiritual experience that forces us to think about issues we may have long avoided. And as I said before, we all know grief. One famous writer described grief as the silent, knife-like terror and sadness that comes 100 times a day when you start to speak to someone who is no longer there. The emptiness that comes when you eat alone with another, after eating with another for many years, teaching yourself to go to bed without saying goodnight to the one who has died, and the helpless wishing that things were different when you know they're not and never will be again. Grief is a whole cluster of adjustments and apprehensions and uncertainties that strike life in its forward progress and make it difficult to redirect the energies of life. We grieve for lots of reasons, and part of it comes from the separation. Death is about separation. It is about the pain we feel from our loss. But when death comes, Jesus knows about our pain, and he shares in our grief because he too has been there. Jesus weeps with us so that we may someday laugh and rejoice with him. And because of Jesus, death, my brothers and sisters in Christ, is not the end of life. He said, "Because I live, you shall live also. I am the resurrection and the life. They who believe in me shall never die." No time is a good time to lose a loved one. Sometimes we may like to suggest that it should be an easy matter to part with an old person, somebody 90 years old or 100, or one who has lost a battle with a prolonged illness. But this is not so. No matter how old that person is, we still grieve. Even when we knew it was coming, we grieve. We grieve because we have lost more than our loved one. We have lost a part of ourselves. Sometimes our grief comes from a sense of our own mortality. Who can go to the funeral of a friend without thinking about his own future demise? Most of us are perhaps like the man who said, "It is not that I'm afraid to die, I just don't want to be there when it happens." We grieve at others' deaths because it forces us to think about our own. The Word of God acknowledges that we will grieve and nothing will change that. The great saints of the Bible knew grief. We know Abraham. Abraham was grieved over the passing of his wife Sarah. Isaac was still grieving 3 years after his mother's death. King David wept when his friend Jonathan died. And who can forget the grief of Job at the loss of his children? Even Jesus wept at the grave of Lazarus. And the Word of God even describes Jesus himself as a man of sorrows, Isaiah 53 and 3. Jesus knew what it is to grieve. And grief is not bad, it is not wrong. I believe grief is a response to the way God made us, creatures that love and care and hurt when we lose a loved one. Grief is a universal experience, and there is a common likeness on the outside with those who grieve. Their tears are no tears. Their sorrowful looks, etc. But on the inside, it is another matter. Without a future to look to with that loved one, grief easily turns to anger for some and frustration with everyone and everything. Grief without hope is never, ever a pretty picture. And so Paul instructs us in 1 Thessalonians 4:13. He said, "Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope." We can thank God today that his word offers us hope and comfort in times of our grief and our sorrow. From the lessons we heard today, you know, the Psalm 23, we heard, "The Lord is my shepherd, and even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil." Why? Because the Lord is with me. I want to turn to Psalm 23 for that comfort that we may all be seeking this evening. For hundreds of years, the 23rd Psalm has been one of the most treasured passages in all Holy Scripture. It is among the most familiar, so much so that even people who are not religious or very knowledgeable about Scripture recognize these words. They're among the most comforting, often being quoted in times of trouble or distress, and almost always being read when we gather in church for a funeral. There are many images in this psalm which hold particular meaning. So this reflection today is not only for those who are grieving, but for any one of you in here this evening who are going through challenging times. The first image from this psalm: "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me." It would be so wonderful if God would simply promise to us that we would never go through difficult times. But we do go through great and terrible difficulties all the time. And God constantly warns us of these dangers and difficulties in his holy word. St. Peter wrote in his first letter, he said, "Dear friends, do not be surprised at the painful trial you are suffering, as though something strange were happening to you." And the Word of God constantly tells us that there will be difficult times in life. And so Psalm 23 voices also such a warning. It does not say God will keep you from danger, trials, challenges, or grief, but rather it describes that there will come times, and they will come for all of us, when we feel like we are walking through a dark, dangerous valley, a valley of the shadow of death. And I don't know how many of you feel the same way, but I feel the same way in these dark times because we are living in such a dark world. And really and truly, I feel as though I'm walking through a valley of the shadow of death. But what the Word of God does not, what it makes clear, very clear, is that as we move through such times, God is with us. God is still in control. And God is there to comfort us, and He's there to sustain us. As I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for your rod and staff, they comfort me. God is frequently described in the Bible as being like a shepherd who cares for and tends to a flock of sheep. He protects, he guides, he supports, he comforts, and he does not send us through the dark valley with a cheery promise to meet us again on the other side. Brothers and sisters, he goes with us through that valley every single step of the way. Perhaps in recent times, our brother could certainly have talked about how he had been through such a valley of the shadow of death, but he was never, ever alone. Not only did he have his family, but he had the Holy Spirit of God at his side, like a shepherd who kept close watch on him. And I think that's why he lives so long. And even now, at the time of his departure, he is not traveling to the other side alone. A second image in this 23rd Psalm to which I would call our attention is this: Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. There is a report, I read this somewhere, about a veteran of World War I. He had fascinating stories to tell, and one of them was about a battle that had taken place in Europe. He was an American, but he had actually enlisted with the British Army, and he was fighting in the war for quite some time before most Americans. He was fighting on a stretch of land for days on end, and both armies seemed to be at a stalemate. And it so happened that the battle continued into Christmas Day. The fighting stopped and all was quiet. And late in the morning, the German officers raised the white flag and they moved toward the British lines and under a flag of truce conferred with the British officers. And after extended conversation, the two armies agreed to pool some of their food together for a Christmas meal. The soldiers of each side joined together and ate together, and they sang a few songs together that had different words but common tunes. If you know anything about that period of history, we may remember that these armies hated one another, as Americans especially hated Germans with a deeply racist attitude. But there they were eating together at a table, or at least on the ground in the presence of an enemy. The veteran said that after that it was hard to go back to fighting the next day because they had shared food together. They had sang songs of Christ's birth together. And he said he had glimpsed a time in the future when all of them would be together in heaven and all their earthly conflicts would disappear. It is like the glimpse that John the Divine had in the book of Revelation. John said, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea," meaning chaos. There was no more chaos. "And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away.' And he who was seated on the throne said, 'I am making all things new.'" Are we preparing ourselves to sit at that table when that time comes, that great day comes? And the third image in this 23rd Psalm, which I would lift up today, is this: Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. My brothers and sisters in Christ, the end of our journey through life on earth is to be with God forever. The end of our journey in baptism, we are made members of the household of God. And our destiny is made secure through our faith in Christ. And sometimes our journey is filled with joy. Sometimes it can be very sad and lonely. Yet, the promise that God has already given us eternal life with Him sustains us in our journey, and it gives substance to our hope. The goodness and the mercy that follow us are not something that we achieve ourselves. They're given to us by the sheer grace of God. And were it not for God's forgiveness, then our sins and mistakes would quickly disqualify us for eternal life. But with God, there's goodness and mercy supremely evident in His Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. Our life on earth and our life with God forever are because of His grace alone. And this is something all of us do well to remember as we look now to the days ahead. The grief we feel and all the emotions that go with that grief can tempt us to unbelief and irrational behavior and deep and dark sadness. Nevertheless, the goodness and mercy of God will follow us all the days of our life, giving us broad latitude to work through our grief, through our sorrow, and it will grant us forgiveness for our mistakes. For it is not God's will that anyone living or dead be separated from Him forever. We have gathered in this hour not only to grieve the death of Darnley, but to give thanks to God for His life among us and for His eternal life now with God. We have gathered not only to mourn over how different lives will be without Him, but to give God thanks for how full life was when He was with us in our midst. We have gathered not only to consider the shortness and uncertainty of life in this church on earth, but we've also gathered here to give thanks to God for His gift of eternal life in the church in heaven. For the church on earth and the church in heaven, I believe there are not two churches, it is one church, even as the Lord who calls us into being is one Lord, the good shepherd of all the saints, both living and dead. Rest eternal grant unto him, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon him. I take this opportunity on behalf of the parish of St. Luke to extend our sincerest condolences to the relatives and friends of our brother Darnley. And as I said when I began, if there's anyone here who may be going through any challenges in life, I want to encourage you that Jesus is our shepherd, and whatever it is you're going through, He is there for you. Whatever challenge it is, Jesus is there with you. And we're living in such difficult times. We're living in times of, I don't say uncertainty, because I know and I believe with all my heart what is going to happen. I believe and I look forward to the second coming of Christ. But we are living in some difficult times. And I pray that, I just urge you, if you're not a believer, if you haven't given your life to the Lord God, which you ought to do, I pray that God will open your ears and your eyes to see Him, your ears to hear Him speak to you and calling you, because no matter who you are or where you are in your spiritual life, He's knocking on your door every day. A lot of people say, I can't hear God, he doesn't exist and all that, but He's there knocking on your door every day, and His word says, Behold, I stand at the door and knock, and whoever opens that door, I will come in and I will sup with him. He also says, I think it's in the book of Jeremiah, he talks about seeking after him and seeking after him diligently. Yeah? And those who do that, when we seek after God diligently, then he promises that we will find him. But I want to tell you that he is real. He exists. Yeah? A lot of us may be all up in the pleasures of this world, but there ain't nothing sweeter than Jesus. Right, David? Nothing, nobody that's sweeter than he. Right? So, as I tell you, these days are, these times are difficult times, they're challenging times, and I believe they're going to get worse. And now is the time that we should be preparing ourselves for those difficult times. There's a lot of Christian persecution going on around the world. We still here, you know, we can't talk about that Christian persecution, but a time is coming. And if we read the Word of God, if we are alert and aware of things that are going on in our world, as Jesus commanded us to do, he tells us to be always alert. Yeah? If we are alert, then we will see the changes that are taking place across the entire world. Don't laugh at me. I think people here going to think they're talking foolishness. I ain't talking foolishness. Because I know who I believe. Yeah? I know who I believe. Let me tell you. Yeah? So I want to sit down and laugh. Yeah? I remember what the Bible tells about that. Those who laugh now will be crying later. But we need to get serious. And especially, I want to speak to the church. Because we ourselves need to get serious about our Christian life. We need to get serious about what we believe. Yeah, there's going to come a time. Remember, the Word of God says that even the elect will be tempted to fall away. So we have to prepare for that day. We have to make ourselves strong in the Lord. That is all I have to tell you this evening. Remember, Reverend Lucas tell you, sir, what the day there is? Huh? The 13th of April, 2023. Let us stand and affirm our faith. In the words of the Apostles' Creed, it's in your booklet. I believe in God the Father, Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please kneel for our prayers. Our response will be, hear us, Lord. For our brother Darnley, let us pray to the Lord Christ, who said, I am resurrection and I am life. Lord, you consoled Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to those who mourn for Darnley and dry the tears of those who weep. You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow. You raised the dead to life. Raise our brother Darnley to eternal life. You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our brother Darnley to the joys of heaven. Our brother was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give him fellowship with all your saints. He was nourished with your body and blood. Grant him a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom. Comfort us in our sorrows at the death of our brother Darnley. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope.
Please stand. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints.
Where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting.
You only are immortal, the creator and maker of mankind. And we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant and your saints.
Your sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting.
Lord of mercy, Christ of mercy, Lord, mercy. O Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Let us commend our brother Darnley to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Deliver your servant Darnley, O sovereign Lord Christ, from all evil, and set him free from every bond, that he may rest with all your saints in the eternal habitations, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Darnley. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, in the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Rest eternal grant unto Darnley, O Lord.
And let light perpetual shine upon him.
Through the tender mercies of God, rest in peace.
Amen. During the singing of our final hymn, we will take a collection, which will go towards the upkeep of our graveyard. The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Our final hymn.
Hymn 564.
Storms of life, when the clouds
I ain't getting enough noise. I ain't getting enough sound. Huh? Third verse. Wally, play the last verse again, please. Let's sing the last verse and the chorus again. Thank you for the hands that had to offer. We ask you to bless them. We also ask you to bless the hands that did not have to offer, O loving Father God, but we ask that we will, by your grace, use this money, O loving Father God, for the upliftment of your church and the furtherance of your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Not the metis.
Oh,
glad, and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope. You will show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore. I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this. Happy are the dead who die in the faith of Christ. Henceforth, says the Spirit, they may rest from their labors, for they take with them the record of their deeds. Man born of a woman has but a short time to live. Like a flower, he blossoms and then withers. Like a shadow, he flees and never stays. In the midst of life, we are in death. To whom can we turn for help but to you, Lord, who are justly angered by our sins? Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of eternal death. You know the secrets of our hearts. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive us our sins. And at our last hour, let us not fall away from you.
Ensure in certain hope of resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend it to Almighty God, our brother Darnley, and we commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, and we beseech you in your infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor, that when your well-beloved Son shall come again in judgment, both this our brother Darnley and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray.
Almighty God, with whom still live the spirits of those who die in the Lord, and with whom the souls of the faithful are in joy and felicity, we give you heartfelt thanks for the good examples of all your servants who, having finished their course in faith, now find rest and refreshment. May we, with all who have died in the true faith of your holy name, have perfect fulfillment and bliss in your eternal and everlasting glory, through Jesus Christ, O Lord.
Amen.
Grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. And this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Rest eternal grant to Darnley, O Lord.
And let light perpetual shine upon him.
May he and all the faithful departed through the tender mercies of God rest in peace.
Our first hymn during the committal, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Continue with Sing the Wondrous Love of Jesus.
Thank you.
when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound. Sweet by and by.
Thank you. This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. I have a loving mother just over in glory land, and I don't expect to stop until I shake her hand. She's waiting now for me in heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Just over in glory land we'll live eternally. The saints on every hand are shouting victory. Their songs of sweetest praise drip back from heaven's shore, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away, by and by, I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have flown, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison bars has flown, I'll fly away. Hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, yes, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, you by and by, I'll fly away. I have lived a life of sin in this world I'm living in. I have done forbidden things I shouldn't do. I ask a beggar along the way if he could tell me where to stay, where I could find real happiness and love that's true. Across the bridge, there's no more sorrow. Across the bridge, there's no more pain. The sun will shine across the river, and you'll never be unhappy again. Footsteps of the King, till you hear the voices ring, they'll be singing out the glory of the land. The River Jordan will be near, the sound of trumpets you will hear, and you'll behold the most precious place ever known to man. Across the bridge, there's no more sorrow. Across the bridge, there's no more pain. The sun will shine across the river, and you'll never be unhappy again. Across the bridge, there's no more sorrow. Across the bridge, there's no more pain. The sun will shine across the river, and you'll never be unhappy again.
Let us pray. Hear, Lord, the praise of your people, as we remember before you Darnley, our brother, and grant that we who confess your name on earth may with him be made perfect in the kingdom of your glory, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Remember, O Lord, this your servant, who has gone before us with the sign of faith and now rests in the sleep of peace. According to your promises, grant to him and to all who rest in Christ refreshment, light, and peace, through the same Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord bless him and keep him. The Lord make his face to shine upon him and be gracious unto him. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon him and give him peace. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Thanks be to God.
I want to give everyone thanks and praise for attending here this afternoon. We know that Darnley Lowe, he's in a better place right now. I thank you all for coming. I appreciate it. It means a whole lot to me and my family. I appreciate you all. Thanks very much. God bless.